So from the last talk, I just wanted to mention, I teach permaculture at Cabrillo College, and the last couple of years I got to Tal Sahara as kind of a preparation for the class. And maybe I was there when our last speaker was there, and it's an awesome place. I recommend it. And also, Cabrillo College, our arboretum status is for our salvia collection. So I highly recommend coming to Cabrillo for a tour. You can go do a self-guided tour of the salvia garden. And we've got salvias from all over the world, and that's really a fun collection. And we have, on Mother's Day in May, we have an annual plant sale, and a lot of those salvias are available at the plant sale. So, love to see you there. Do I point it somewhere?
It should just go. Try again. Again,
maybe. Am I pushing the bell button? How did you do that?
The bottom.
Okay. So, specifically, how can permaculture techniques work with nature to slow water and allow you to create a no-water garden? That's quite a concept. I'll do my best. No water is a tall order. So what, to my mind, what makes permaculture relevant, and yes, even brilliant, is that it is the science of maximizing beneficial relationships. And that, in a way, that's a bit of a glib, short, one-line description of permaculture, but permaculture is notoriously hard to pin down or describe. And I like this one because it's broad, the implications of this are broad, and it's not just the garden. We can apply permaculture at any scale, at any location, and not just gardens, but we can design farms and cities and communities with the concepts of permaculture. So it's the beneficial relationships that we're looking at. And there's the thing of the concept of stability, and a diverse garden isn't necessarily stable until we draw the connections between the different elements. As Bill Mollison, who is the co-originator of permaculture, says, that design is a connection between things. It's not water, it's not a chicken or the tree, it's how the water, the chicken, and the tree are connected. It's the opposite of what we're taught in school often. Education takes everything apart, pulls it apart, and makes no connections at all. With permaculture, we make the connections because as soon as you have the connections, you can feed the chicken from the tree. So from a permaculture perspective, we really can't pull out one thing like water conservation or a response to drought as separate from issues, or just because that we're having a drought. In other words, kind of the reductionist kind of, well, we're having a drought, so we're going to deal with water, and that's the frame of that. If anything, permaculture is a whole systems approach to the challenges of our time. And so it's a response that is less about techniques and methods and more about a way of thinking or a way of approaching challenges or constraints. So it's about turning problems into solutions and design constraints into opportunities. And if anything, the drought is a design constraint. And it's only how we see things that make them advantageous or not. So I want to say a little bit about permaculture and kind of go back to give you a little bit of orientation real quickly. It's a design science that's based on ethics, and the first ethic is care for the earth. And the next ethic is care for people. And the third ethic is fair share. And so for my money, design science that is based on ethics is where I want to go, and it is a system that is completely relevant to our times now. So we start with those ethics, and we're filtering everything through these ethics. Are we taking care of the planet? Are we taking care of the earth, the people? And then the idea of the third ethic, we often also say that it's care for the future. So, and often the idea that as we're designing for yield, we're using the surplus or the yield to take care of the earth and the people. So there's a whole bunch of permaculture principles. And this book here by David Holmgren, who's the co-originator of the permaculture concept with Bill Mollison. And this is David Holmgren, and his book is Permaculture Principles and Pathways Beyond Sustainability. And in teaching permaculture, it's very useful because he has taken the principles and really defined them and put them and given an icon to them and kind of distilled them down to 12 principles. And I'm not going to go through all the principles, but the ones that are relevant to our discussion today. The second principle is catch and store energy. And that's entirely relevant to our topic today. And by developing systems that collect resources when they are abundant, we can use them in times of need, as in drought. So this principle is absolutely relevant. This is water catchment. That's what it looks like. And our sixth principle is produce no waste. And so by valuing and making use of all the resources that are available to us, nothing goes to waste. So I wanted to mention these two principles out of the 12, because these are the ones that are really apropos to our talk today. So it's the most common substance on Earth, and we waste a lot of it. 1% is drinkable, and of that water that we can actually use. And meanwhile, it takes 39,090 gallons of water to make a car, including the tires. And I saw a movie the night before last called Cowspiracy, and it's about animal agriculture and making the point that animal agriculture is one of the biggest wasters of water on the planet, or users of water and wasters of water. It takes 660 gallons of water to make 1/4 pounder of beef. So we might consider, in the bigger picture, even our agriculture with respect to animals. So we talked about 50 gallons. That's low for a lot of us, maybe, but we can do it. And that's an important thing. Here we have, it's hard to see, but it's, is it 47 or 57?
57%
is used out in the landscape. That's plummeted now with all our water restrictions. In Santa Cruz, we have some pretty steep water restrictions. But it's a lot of water that is used outside. So in Santa Cruz, we have some great programs. We have rebates for everything from gray water. Well, we have in SoCal Water District, we have rebates for rainwater catchment, for gray water, for taking out loans, and converting spray systems to drip systems. And Los Angeles is asking people to go down 20%. This is like 2 months ago. Oh no, I took a picture similar to this one where there was overspray going on for an hour at an intersection and incredible waste. And so that I'm sure has stopped. So it's important for us to kind of get a handle on the hydrological cycle for starters. And in a natural setting, here we got 10% runoff and 25% underground deep infiltration. In an urban setting, we got 55% runoff, sometimes higher. San Francisco has an incredible amount of impervious surface that they are having to deal with. And figuring out how they can get water into the ground. But water into the ground is where we want that. Because otherwise, it's got no place to go. So that's just a comparison between a natural system and an urban system with the runoff. And this is kind of ideally what we're looking at, the hydrological cycle. But the whole process, and we were talking about the hydrological cycle this morning in my class, and the whole process of evaporation from the oceans, precipitation, the water going down into the ground, taken up by plants, evapotranspiration, and it continues. So it does have this, our response, permaculture response to the drought, is really, it's a puzzle with a lot of different pieces. Rainwater catchment, Hugelkultur, we'll talk about that in a second, sheet mulching, gray water, that's a bio-swale sign, obviously, and here we're digging some swales in my with my permaculture class, and and put that in drip systems. So this is a few items that make up the puzzle that is our response. So there's conservation, there's reusing water, and there's storing water in these different ways. And so this makes up how we're going to address drought and water conservation in general. In the Santa Cruz area, we have the challenge of the idea of desalination, which is a huge consumer of electricity and has a huge carbon footprint and a lot of wastewater brine that goes back into the ocean. And I think it's got some real major problems. It's not just a magic bullet, but we do have obviously some huge problems that we have to address, and we think we can do it with conservation in a lot of ways. Definitely want to find where we're wasting water the most. So don't just take it standing up and fix it. Do things like, you know, using smart water timers are great. It's high technology, good way to go. And runoff from communities or our home that have smart water timers, the runoff plummets, yeah, because we're looking at soil type, plant type, irrigation type, slope, aspect, zip code. It's connected with, you know, with satellite often. So there's a lot of reasons why this is an intelligent approach to water conservation. I'm not sure this is the best response to drought. Synthetic turf, I did see a synthetic turf field here at Foothill. And it's got challenges, it's got some huge challenges. I wrote an article called Synthetic Turf, Fake Grass, or Stepford Lawns. And basically the point I wanted to make is that, have you ever seen the movie The Stepford Wives? Right? And there's a point in the movie where one of the wives gets stabbed and it messes with her wiring and she starts repeating, I thought we were friends. I thought we were friends. I thought we were friends. Well, that's what I imagine synthetic turf is saying when I stab it with my accusations of it being a pseudo-green product. Because yes, we don't have to mow it, we don't have to fertilize, we don't have to irrigate, aerate, all these things, but we have an amazing amount of waste, a huge heat island effect that's increased with the heat from synthetic turf. You still have to clean it, you have to clean it with disinfectants, and the ground underneath it is pretty unhappy, it's impervious, and at the end of its lifespan, it's going off to the dump. So we still have to figure out where the land of a way is, but that's where our synthetic turf is going after we're done with it. As opposed to, here's a native bluff on the north coast from Santa Cruz. And permaculture is all about working with nature rather than against nature. And when we can see a native bluff like this with amazing plants, I would call nature a mentor. And here's an Indian paintbrush. And I had to take a while, it took me a while to, I had to wait for that seagull. But that's right on the bluff on the north coast of Santa Cruz. And it's a spectacular spot there, and there's some really wonderful native plant bluffs along the north coast there. It's worth a trip. This is a salvia. I think it's a white sage. So this is often we'll go out to a site when we know we're going to have problems. This is a site where I went out to in the middle of a rainstorm, and we had water that wasn't going away. We had a general store and a ranch house at a resort, the Costanoa Resort on the north coast. And when it would rain, there was no place where the water would go, and so they would have a moat around their general store and their ranch house. And so we figured out how to drain that water away. We took these lawns out and put in natives and Mediterranean plants and a few edibles. So do you recognize this as a drip system? This is an early drip system, right? The original drip system seeping out from an unglazed pot. And you bury the pot in the ground, fill it with water, and it seeps out. And so Robert Cork just gave a great presentation on drip. And I have some questions about that for him. But absolutely, this is part of one of the pieces of the puzzle. This is just on the side, but you can do PVC-free irrigation. It's an innovative way to go, and there are some products that are, while they're still polyethylene, you can get away from toxins, and PVC being one of the more toxic products that we use in the industry, polyvinyl chloride, it's worth getting away from if we can. So this is one strategy out of many. And I just looked, I was just helping a friend in Santa Cruz put in a wicking garden bed. And this system here, it could be termed kind of subsurface irrigation, but basically it's a raised garden bed that has a receptacle at the bottom and then a membrane here of like weed fabric and then soil above that. So then you can fill the water in here. The water stays down here, separated by a fabric or a filter fabric, and then the soil wicks the water up. So that is a couple pictures of that. And here we're filling water. There's all kinds of things, products you can buy that are already made, like that, or you can build a whole raised garden bed and have a system that has this kind of a receptacle cistern below the growing medium where the roots can access that. Who all has heard of Hugelkultur? Good. We've got a lot of projects in Santa Cruz. We have a grange in Santa Cruz called the Green Grange, and they have a wonderful garden there with a small orchard, and they have rainwater catchment that flushes their toilets, and they've got solar on their roof, and they have a Hugelkultur bed. And this is the idea of Hugelkultur, is that you're burying carbon in a lot of different forms, logs, branches, smaller logs, and then you build that up with straw, and you can have a long-term bread. The idea is that as the carbon begins to rot, you have a sponge that's holding on to water that the roots can access. And I've seen some remarkable beds. This gives a little diagram of the process. But here we have the larger logs, smaller, and branches, and twigs, and then straw, and then soil. And just laying them down like this. And so again, it's not like that we have one permaculture method, but it's really about a way of thinking, a way of approaching an issue or a problem, and finding solutions within that problem. So you can sequester carbon in your own backyard. This is just a fun little raised bed. It's a Hugelkultur bed made with straw, and the wood is in the middle. Straw is the walls, and then you fill it with soil. And I've got this growing now, and plants are very happy there. And I was over at the Grange day before yesterday, and the woman who her son put in the Hugelkultur bed there at the Grange was kind of giddy about how it was working, and just grabbed my arm and said, "I don't think we know what a gift we have in Hugelkultur. The potential that we have in Hugelkultur in growing plants in a way that takes a lot less water." So it's a really fun kind of creative thing to do, and you can have a party and build a Hugelkultur bed. So these are just a few examples. This is one I did not do, but I put in the rest of these, and these are all just examples of raised beds using recycled material or straw or natural material or urbanite. This is urbanite beds made from reused concrete. This is salvage lumber, straw. This is sustainably harvested lumber. And these are all rocks that were throwaway rocks from the lumber from the landscape supply place nearby. And that's kind of a fun way to use this wine barrel. So, as Terry was talking about, the soil food web and building compost and building your soil and how important that is to water conservation, creating a soil that is going to be like a sponge that's going to hold on to that water and make it available when it's needed. Here we're doing a compost demonstration. This is about 20 years ago when I had a brown beard. And my friend here, Craig, has a chef's hat on to show that building compost is, you have to have all the right ingredients. It's like baking a loaf of bread. You've got to have carbon and nitrogen and oxygen and water, and then you put it together and you let it cook. And my class was putting a compost bed together today, a certified organic compost pile that has to be turned five times in 15 days and has to maintain a temperature between 131 and 170 degrees for 15 days. So it kills all the pathogens. And then you can use that as a certified organic compost. So I think you heard about all this, right?
Yeah.
All our friends.
Yeah. Yeah.
And there are a lot of friends there that we need to be aware of. So here's the outputs going away, and a lot of times they're collected with a blower, blowing off the soil, And we have a project in Santa Cruz called the Leaf Blower Task Force that I started. And we're in the process of gathering information in the community. We've got 500 plus surveys back so far, and we're looking for to put together an action plan around blowers. But it's not just the noise, and the reason it's apropos here and relevant here is that we're blowing away mulch and natural mulch that covers the soil, and then we're hauling it away using fossil fuels to take it to the dump where they may be composted, hopefully. And I mean, why do we call them leaves? Anyhow. Chai mulch. Okay, I got to talk about chai mulch. And so I was looking on a website, a free cycle website, and discovered chai waste. And I thought, chai waste, okay, that's an interesting concept. So I went and looked at it, and it was cinnamon, allspice, ginger, clove, cardamom, pepper, star anise. And the company was filling up a dumpster every week and paying for it to go to the dump. And I said, no, no, I'll take it. And so I started taking it, calling it chai mulch, and selling it to my clients. And it smells like chai, it looks great, keeps weeds down, keeps moisture in the ground, and looks good. So that's chai mulch. And here's another kind of fun thing that I can't do a slideshow without showing some of these things, and I have to do my best to make sure that it's relevant to the topic. So this was a company in Santa Cruz, a tea company, that every time tax time would come around, they would call me and say, we've got a bunch of tea that's going to the landfill because we've got to offload product. Do you want it? And I would say, well, sure. I'll take it. It's mulch, in my mind. It's organic matter. And so one time that they were closing the shop, it was Good Earth Tea in Santa Cruz. They were closing their shop in Santa Cruz, a warehouse, and because they had another one on the East Coast. And so they had a dumpster, I mean not a dumpster, they had a semi-truck load of herbs. And so I said, okay, I'll take it. And I ended up with 1,000 pounds of hibiscus tea unused in bags. Hibiscus tea, rosehip tea, rose petals, and almost 900 pounds of kosher food grade pink crushed rose petals in boxes going to the landfill. And so I said, no, it's not going to the landfill. And what else? I had rosehip powder, chamomile tea, and so I started using it as a mulch. And here's chai mulch, and here's hibiscus tea. And this is rose petal, rose hip, and this is rose petal. And then I had so much of it I didn't know what to do, so I started making mandalas with the herbs. And, so how does this relate to drought response? Okay, it's mulch. That's what it is, it's mulch. And it is mulch, and it's a great, we gotta have mulch. But the thing that we learned, certainly from what we've learned about native bees, is the opposite is true. Yes, we want to mulch, mulch, mulch. We want to conserve moisture, keep weeds down, have aesthetically looking, that's aesthetic, eh? But we also want to leave some ground bare for ground nesting bees. So that's an important thing, and we have to think of all the creatures that are in our garden, whether they're coming to the flowers or nesting in the ground, or in the rocks, even some of them are. So we've got Golden is in the audience.
Hey, Golden? Here. Yeah.
And we got the Central Coast Grey Water Alliance. This is Sherry, who's our leader. And we have a great group in Santa Cruz. And this is a big project that we're doing in Santa Cruz. I hope you all are catching on to it. Permaculture has been doing gray water since the late 70s. So, you know, we didn't come up with gray water just now because, oh, we're in a drought, let's do gray water. 20 years we're going, hey, this is an obvious thing, let's do it. And so it's a simple thing, and thanks to Arnold Schwarzenegger, he signed into the California Plumbing Code that You can put in a laundry the landscape system without a permit as long as you follow the guidelines. And some of those are exemplified there. But when it comes to water conservation, the solutions are not black and white, they are gray. And this is a diverter valve, and here's a vent that prevents the water from siphoning back into the washing machine. That's a mulch basin that sends the water out to the landscape. And here's a class that we did where students are installing a diverter valve. So an important response to drought that is high time that we do this. And here's the map for the Central Coast area of, and this is just the beginning of where the gray water systems are located in Santa Cruz area. And there's a lot more now than when this was this image was captured. So we are talking about creative ways of using and reusing, capturing, restoring, conserving water. This is a surfer shower in Santa Cruz, halfway built, and the water directly goes, from the shower after the walls are up, the water goes directly out to the garden. So that's just one creative way. And here's a goofy one. This is me, my bathtub. I don't have a crawl space under my house, and so I don't have any way of accessing the bathtub. It's plumbing. And so I can't access that water unless I do a major rework of the foundation. So I have a bilge pump. And who needs the gym? Just alternate arms and pump it out. Pole goes out and then goes out to the gray water system outside. And so it feeds water, waters plants outside, and it's good water. Plants are happy with it. And that works, and it's good exercise. So don't discount exercise you can get from a bilge pump gray water system. This is a school we have in Santa Cruz, an awesome school, Gateway School in Santa Cruz, where they have a gray water system and a rainwater catchment system. But this system is two code, and it goes from their sink, goes into a three-tiered constructed wetland where the water is purified, going through a plant constructed wetland. And then I think right there is a hand pump that the kids then can pump the water into their watering cans and water the garden. So it's a real beautiful example for the kids. They're learning, they're doing it, they're in action, and they're interactive with the garden. And we just had a great tour in Santa Cruz by Slow Food Santa Cruz, nice response to fast food. And we had an edible garden tour in Santa Cruz. And their garden was on the tour, and all the kids were the ones that were giving the tour and telling everybody about their system, their rainwater system and their rainwater catchment system and their living mulch with their fava beans, and it was awesome, really cool. This is just a fun little aside. This is an herb tea brewer, and I have a pump that aerates this. And then I throw in here, I use gray water into this. I aerate it with a powerful aerating pump. So it's got air pumping into it. So one thing I want to say about gray water is that you never store it. And the only reason this is viable is that I don't store it for more than a couple days, but I'm aerating it the whole time. And I'm adding worm castings, and sometimes I'll add other manure, or earth from the garden, like comfrey or nettles or chamomile, and making an herb, manure, compost, tea that I aerate so the pathogens are kept down low, and then we just take the watering can and water that into the garden. So it's a way of making on-site fertilizer that is really tailored for your garden, because it's got, for my garden, because I've got my own worm castings in there and my own herbs. And I don't have chickens currently, but wherever I can get local manure. So it's a way of kind of circumventing the product cycle of fertilizers. And I can't talk about water conservation without talking about humanure. The title says it all. I love the title. I saw that our fellow speak here, the author, Jared, and I just think that here, this is a great quote from New Yorker magazine. It's a cult classic which might strike those without an outhouse as disgusting, but the methods outlined within have the potential to change the ecological fate of the world. Because we use an awful lot of water to flush our waste. And potable water. And 20% of the energy in California goes to pumping water around and making it potable. And then we do all that energy, and then we flush toilets with it. There has got to be a better way to do this. And this is one of the ways. This doesn't take water. You can get a, there's a service that goes to music festivals instead of the stinky porta potties that are pretty disgusting. These things, the outhouses for humanure, don't smell because you alternate wood chips, and you go in there and it doesn't smell. And then they take that and they compost it. They compost it for a year, so the pathogens are taken care of. There's no water flushing. It's something to consider. I'm not saying any one of these is the answer, but there is no magic bullet. There's no magic solution to this. It is absolutely a puzzle. We've got to think of ourselves as part of the poop loop, not only including the poop or the manure cycle in our fertilizing regimen and creating our own fertilizers, but where do we fit into this picture? This is another approach, and this is the Resource Conservation District publication out of Santa Cruz. These are also available with other water or resource conservation districts around the state of California. This is a term that was coined by a wonderful man, Brock Dolman, from Occidental Arts and Ecology. If you ever have a chance, watch Brock Dolman on YouTube, his Pioneers Talk. Really worth listening to. He's a poet and a rap artist that knows what he's talking about when it comes to water. He's a biologist and a birder, and he started the Water Institute up in Occidental. And he coined this term, slow it, spread it, sink it, gave permission to the Resource Conservation District to use that term. And that's what we're talking about with, instead of the old paradigm of piping and pumping the water away, 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 is let's learn how to keep it on site, get the water back into the ground table, let the soil take care of any minor problems. If there's major ones, we've got to address that all, obviously. But here, slow it, spread it, and sink it, infiltrate, instead of pumping out and having velocity and volume create erosion downstream, we create a system where we're giving it a lot of places to go. So, and that in the industry, landscape industry now, and in development, it's called LID, low impact development. And that is really taking a cue from permaculture, and the resource conservation districts are really, maybe they don't know it, but they're using techniques straight out of permaculture designer's manual. And that is teaching water to walk instead of run off site and getting it in the ground. And like often when we build here, is when we get into the ground, then we can create, here's a swale, and here's Brock Goldman and Lydia and David Shaw. And this is a permaculture course that we did in Santa Cruz at the Waldorf School. And this course was sponsored by the Regenerative Design Institute. They're out of Bolinas. and they also do a course in Santa Cruz, and I taught with them a couple years. Here we are making A-frames, which is a simple device that helps you find level. And so a swale, the quick definition of a swale is that it's a level, uncompacted ditch. It's a level, uncompacted ditch. And that allows the water, instead of running downhill, collecting volume and velocity, and causing erosion downhill, because it's level, the water can spread out and has enough residency time to sink in. And so it's brilliant. Here we are with an A-frame. And save the swales. And so this is a permaculture class where they're learning how to slow it, spread it, sink it. And here is an example of a swale system that's holding the water, and then some of it's draining into a larger pond. And this, what happens when you have a system like this is that, oops, I'm sorry, underground, you create a lens of water below ground that you can plant those berms, the downhill berms of a swale. You can plant that with trees, with natives, with shrubs, with fruit trees, and those roots can access that water longer than the rainy period, because that water, as it sinks down, creates this lens that continues there long after the rainy season. So rain gardens, this is part of the low impact development that requires that we don't run our water off. And in Santa Cruz, of course, we don't want it. We have an incredible Monterey Bay sanctuary. We don't want the water going down the streets, collecting pollution and oil and gas on the streets and polluting our bay. And so whenever possible, like here at Foothill, I saw cutouts in the parking lot. So the water goes from the parking lot, and there, I don't see a cutout here, but cutout would be like out of the curb, and then the water can drain from the parking lot into this area and fill up. And the idea is that it fills up, and then before it overflows, it's got this overflow grate that the water can go there if it has to, but it has an opportunity to sink in here, and then we can plant it with all kinds of often native plants that are perfect for this kind of condition. Juncus, for instance, awesome plant. Works great, beautiful plant, and a lot of different varieties and forms. So this is an intelligent way of getting that water in the ground. Bio-swales, same, similar concept, can be more specific as a drainage area that is planted and is designed to filter that water. So that's bioswales. Rain gardens and bioswales, similar concept, a little different application. And pervious hardscape, another huge and very important approach to how we can get the water in the ground, because we've got so much impervious surface, not only our rooftops, but streets, sidewalks, driveways, parking lots. And I'm sure you're familiar with pervious concrete, but you can also take urbanite, plenty of urbanite. And here is my crew putting in an installation of a urbanite patio. This was a swimming pool, and then we put in a patio here and raised garden beds out of urbanite. Here we stained the urbanite with a non-toxic stain made out of soy. It's called soycrete, and it's a non-toxic stain with a number of different colors. This we chose a terracotta color, but they have like half a dozen or maybe 10 different colors.
Wow.
And so, you know, you can take old concrete and give it a new stain, plant some thyme in between it or not, put in base rock in between it, Here, we're putting in a patio at an organic farm on the north coast called Pie Ranch, or next to Pie Ranch, and they host weddings. And so this is a wedding alcohol bar outside that we put in an urbanette patio. Rainwater catchment. In Santa Cruz, maybe where you are, you all have bay-friendly landscaping? Are you familiar with bay-friendly landscaping? Yeah, bay-friendly landscaping, awesome. Well, now we're taking the concept to Santa Cruz and we're branding it for the Monterey Bay, so it's Monterey Bay-friendly landscaping. And instead of your pelican, we've got an egret on our side. So it's good stuff, and it's all about slow it, spread it, sink it. Yes to rainwater catchment, yes to drip systems, taking lawns out, converting spray systems to drip, rebates for doing all those things. Santa Cruz, or at least SoCal Water District, has $1 per square foot of lawn taken out. And of course you have to have them come prove that you have a lawn first. Otherwise, they don't want a whole lot of people with a weed patch claiming that they're taking out their weed patch. But this is one of the early landscapes that's being rated as a Monterey Bay-friendly landscape. And I'm proud to say that I'm a new rater for Monterey Bay-friendly landscaping. So I can go out and I can go through the 10 criteria that are part of the bay-friendly landscaping, and they're all about the things that we're talking about here and more. Here is a landscape at the Monterey Bay, it's got the longest title in the world, National Monterey Bay Sanctuary Exploration Center. And they capture the water off the roof, got a beautiful stainless steel tank. The water has a nice overflow that goes into a rain garden, so it doesn't cause erosion as it's overflowing. And even in the dry, dry months, they have an aquarium. It's a pseudo aquarium because it doesn't have live animals, and so it's not salt water, it's fresh water to show, it's kind of their demonstration of a natural system, but it doesn't have salt in it. So they can pump their water out of their tank when they have to clean it and pump it into their cistern and then reuse it in the garden. And the garden is full of native plants, juncus, deer grass, ceanothus. They even have coyote brush in their bacillus. So it's fun and an absolute appropriate permaculture response to drought. Rainwater catchment. And here was a situation where we had just like 2.5 feet between the house and the fence. We daisy, these are the tanks that were 250 gallons, and we daisy chained them together, one after another, so that they had almost 1,000 gallons of rainwater catchment. So that's a great thing. It can get high tech. You can do high tech where you take the rainwater, put it into a pressurized tank, and then put it into your irrigation, like drip, low flow drip. In this case, the client was happy to just have a gravity fed hose that she could just take out to her garden. And that's a lot less expensive, there's less bells and whistles, less parts, moving parts, and a fun way, and there's nothing like having rain and you know that you're getting a deposit in your sister. That's the best, and it's, I mean, it's almost as good as having somebody deposit money in your bank account. So I recommend it. You can go underground with cisterns, of course. They don't have to be above ground. There's all kinds of ways you can do cisterns. You can think of a tree as a cistern. Trees can hold hundreds of gallons of water above ground. And we don't think of it, but a tree is a standing body of water, really. You can keep one, send it into the ground, like we talked about, slow it, spread it, sink it into the ground. You can put it into systems above ground. You can put it into systems below ground. This is a system where you have a pond liner, and then a simplified explanation is it's kind of a pond liner with crates that look like milk crates that hold the shape, and you can do it in any size or configuration. And you can put a parking lot over it. You can have a driveway that is fire truck accessible over the top of one of these. If you're going to be doing major construction anyhow, or putting in a new driveway or something, or a parking lot or a driveway, certainly worth considering this. The biggest piece of the expense on this is digging a hole and finding a place to put the soil. But once you got that figured out, go for it. This is in LA, the Tree People, awesome group in LA area. Now this tank, 216,000 gallon cistern. Now this is below ground. And so they took this paradigm, and instead of this whole concept of LA basin draining all that water, spending billions of dollars to drain that water away wherever that is, and then sending it out to the bay, because we're dealing with stormwater management. And here, Tree People said, no. What we do is we learn how to keep that water and reuse that water instead of draining it away. Let's use that water. So they really came up with some remarkable solutions. I think this is at Golden's house. And this is do-it-yourself rainwater catchment. And these are food-grade barrels that are daisy-chained together. And you can do some low-cost system, do-it-yourself kind of system that doesn't have to cost a lot of money, a little more labor maybe, and plumbing, kind of playing with it, but it's absolutely doable. So it does take courage, and I think with the drought, but know that there are all kinds of solutions, and I do encourage you to look to permaculture for helping guide you in that process. So thanks very much.